Please help me to welcome Dr. Maniket. Dr. Maniket received his degree in mechanical engineering from Chulalongkorn University in Thailand, and then his master's engineering in precision machinery from the University of Tokyo, and also his PhD from the University of Tokyo in the same subject of precision machinery engineering. So Dr. Maniket, currently his expertise lies in robotics, control and measurement, hardware and software design, new robotic mechanisms, novel control algorithms, and innovative measurement concepts. In fact, if you see the exhibition, you will notice several robots which have been developed by Dr. Maniket and his team. Unfortunately, we didn't have time to display these, demonstrate these robots on the opening day. There are two of them outside and one inside, and they do very, very interesting things. So I would like to welcome Dr. Maniket to please start. Thank you very much.
Ladies and gentlemen, we already listened to the two presentations in this session, which focus on the soft side of systems or process. My presentation, which will be the last one of this session, will focus on the other side of the system. So we will focus on the hardware side. So in this presentation, I will explain about how to develop robots or machines, starting from imagination of the creator or innovator until the real implementation, okay, by some companies, by some agency, and etc. Actually, the architecture of any robots or machine, they are exactly the same, even though we call them differently machines or robots, but actually inside the architecture are exactly the same. And this architecture is very similar to human or even living objects, because it consists of three elements, input elements. Like for human, we have six sensations: eye to see, ear to listen to sound, voice, we have tongue to get the taste, we have nose to get the smell, we have skin to get the tactile sensation, and we have the mechanism in our two ears in order to get the balancing. So these are the six sensations of human. Similar to machines or robots, they need this kind of input elements. The second part is the thinking element. For human, we have brains in order to process all of information. Okay, actually, they may be the information from these six sensors, or they may be from the output from the other neural cell, and etc. And the outcome of this processing, they will be shown in the form of the power that actuate our muscle, our arms, our legs, and etc. So these are living animals and humans. But for machines or robots, it also have these three elements, starting from sensors. We need sensors in order to detect the state, internal state of machine or robot. Like sometimes we may need to know that where is the current position of each joint, of each link. So we need like encoders, we need some potentiometers. We need also some the other group of the sensors which are used to detect external environment. Like we have to detect whether parts are coming, we may need to have proximity sensor, limit switch, or we may need to have like machine vision in order to detect the orientation of the parts, so that our robot hand can change the orientation according to orientation of the parts. So these are the input elements. In machine or robot, we have variety of format of processors depending on applications. Sometimes we may use PLC, programmable logic controller. Sometimes we may use microprocessor, microcontroller. Sometimes we may use digital signal processor, or sometimes it might be in the form of FPGA, or in the form of one or several computers, depending on applications. If we have to use the machine or the robot in the environment where we have a lot of noise interference from environment, then we need very robust processor like PLC, because it can handle the voltage up to 24 volt, which is very high compared with microprocessor, which can handle only allow 0 to 5 or 0 to 3.5 if we use CMOS technology. So this is a different kind of processor. But in some applications, if we need to make the robot and machines which need to calculate so difficult mathematics, a lot of high technology signal processing, we may need some kind of digital signal processor. or sometimes if we need to do some we have to compile with very high or very advanced language, sometimes you may need computers, one or several computers. Okay. And in some application, if you need even faster response, you may think about FPGA. So we have variety of format of processor. And lastly, that is the actuation part. So there are varieties of actuation part, like we may apply pneumatic or hydraulic actuators. There are pro and con of these actuators. We may apply electrical motors, which can be in the form of DC, AC, stepping motor, and variety of actuators which are introduced nowadays. So these are the structure which are exactly the same as us. Okay. This knowledge, we call this knowledge as the mechatronics engineering. Actually, AAT is among the first or the pioneer university which launched mechatronics program in this region. Okay, we start more than 10 years ago, but now today nearly all universities see the necessity of mechatronics engineering. Then they launch mechatronics program in undergraduate and also in master and PhD level. Actually, mechatronics, it is the synergic integration of three elements. Mechanism, not mechanical engineering, mechanism only, electronics and computer engineering. The reason that I don't mention that, because some people misunderstood that mechatronics is the combination of mechanical and electrical engineering and computer. Actually, it is not, because mechanical is even bigger. They have thermodynamics, they have heat transfer, power plant, which are not focused at all in mechatronics. We focus on kinematics, kinetics of mechanism and robots. And the other part is about electronics. We don't focus on like power electronic, or we don't go to the level of telecommunication. So this beyond the scope of mechatronics. And the last element, it is the computer technology or IT. Actually, when we think about making a new machines or new robots, there are several causes. And after I analyze, there are actually three major cause or reason that we have to make a new machine or new robot. Firstly, if we have customer, if they ask us, they order us, okay, mostly this kind of machine or robot, we will develop only few, maybe one, or maybe very few at most. So the cost per unit is quite expensive compared with the second group of the robot. Here, sometimes we call this machine or robot like the made-to-order type machines or robot. Sometimes we call it as the tailor-made, because the customer will give all the details about the specification, give in the TOR, and we, the developer, has to look at that. And inside, they don't care, but we have to meet all the specification. So this is the first group. In the second group, we may need to do some market survey to see whether what's are available in the market, what are the weak points, what are the channels that we can do run, or we can run the business on this high competition. Okay, actually, we can. There are several weak points of any system. Like the simplest one is the cost. Maybe the one that available in the market, it is too expensive, or they may have little function, or the function may be not full option. So we still have some channel that we can go into this business. And lastly, even though some product may not be available, but if we do a proper market survey, go to see the potential customer, whether they really want to buy our product. So if you can even ask them to commit that if we make the machine or the robot, then they commit to buy, that will be excellent, but sometimes it is not easy. So the second group of machines or robot is cheaper in terms of the cost per one unit. And lastly, the machine or robot can be created by our imagination of creator, innovator. Just for fun, we don't care about the application. But this kind of imagination, it will ignite future imagination or another dreams that will create a lot of innovative products in the future. Okay. In this talk, I will just only focus on some of the projects that I have conducted at AIT. I don't select some of the products that have maybe when we make some machine for some company, there are some non-disclosure agreement that we cannot say in public. So I only select the one that we have no legal problem. Okay, I will select seven projects. They are flying robot, underwater robot, medical teleanalyzer, intelligent vehicle, unmanned bicycle, exoskeleton, and invert pendulum. To introduce to you how comes one machine become real implementation. Okay, the flying robot is actually it is just a helicopter or it can be an airplane which can fly autonomously from a place to the other place. Actually, the user provide information about the latitude, longitude, about the height, and then let the robot do automatic take off, fly to the mission, maybe change the waypoint until it do the automatic landing. Actually, there are plenty of potential applications. Okay, we can use it. Like when I start the project in the year 2001, we think about using it for agricultural purpose in order to conquer some, in order to get a proper funding from Thailand Research Fund. If we say that we use for other purpose, it may be not easy for that time. But after we finish it, finally we found that using it for agriculture, maybe it is too expensive for the current situation because the farmer may not afford to buy this very expensive hardware. Okay, but finally, my doctoral student who conduct this research, he continued the project to make the national UAV, okay, which cost more than 110 million baht. So this is the video that I keep it for you. This is the presentation that we have the press conference at AAT in the year 2005. The robot do automatic takeoff for 2 meters, fly to the left, actually fly to the west for 2 meters, fly to the north for 2 meters, and come to the east for 2 meters before it come back to the original position before do automatic landing. So this is the first UAV project in Thailand. But after we complete this, Dr. Sukhon Pantunen, he is the doctoral student who conduct this research. He continued this UAV project and get funding from Sawapaw Goho, I'm sorry, in Thai, I don't know the English translation, and also from Thailand Research Fund with the cost of the project more than 110 million baht. The second project is about the development of the machine or the robot that can work in the other environment. Like now, we already have the environment in the air. Okay, we need flying robot in form of helicopter, in form of UAV fixed wing, or in form of quad rotor. There are 4 rotors like helicopter. But if the work must be underwater, so we have to think about the platform. And of course, in the air and underwater, they have different characteristic because we have less problem about the stability. For the flying robot, if you don't control properly, the flying robot will fall easily because you have to control 6 degree freedom, X position XYZ, orientation, roll, pitch, and yaw. So you have to control very fast and real time in order that the flying robot will not fall. It is not like autopilot in the airplane because they fly more than 2,000 miles or kilometers, so they don't care really. Even though there are some small alert, it's still okay. But for flying robot, we have to control in the accuracy of 10 or 15 centimeters. So it is very, very, we have to design a proper control algorithm. So the second one, in case of the underwater robot, we care less on stability, but there are some problem about the limitation of the environment because we can't use GPS. So we have to think about the solution that can that our robot know the current position, whether it is on latitude and longitude. The simplest solution by, okay, if you want to know your own position, come to the surface and get the position and then dive back again to the underwater. But of course, there are a lot of problems. So we develop the local positioning system using sonar, but unfortunately, the accuracy is not very, very good. Finally, we end up with only 4 degree freedom control of the underwater robot. The third project, it was initiated by a doctor at Sirirat Hospital because he teach physiology. Now he become the rector of Sukhothai Thammathirat, Dr. Chairat Pichit Phonchai. he consulted me that, okay, nowadays we can transmit only two information through internet, that is audio and video. But we have six sensation. How can we transmit all the remaining four information through internet so that the people from different sides of the country or of the world, we know each other, we can touch, we can get the smell, we can hear, we can do several things. So after discussion, finally we end up with the machine that can be utilized to diagnose tumors on the patient abdomen. So these are the diseases that it was supposed to detect, like the tumor at spleen or liver. So this is the video that show how the system work. The current diagnosis, we use doctor fingers and hand in order to push on the patient abdomen to send whether there exists or not tumors. So if there exists tumor, the doctor get some feeling. So, but we replace by the machine in such a way that we may need just only one single machine on the doctor's side. There may be several machines on the patient side. The doctor push on the machine. There are 80 cells to detect the motion of the doctor's fingers. And then the information will transmit to the patient side, which transmit three information, audio, video, and also tactile sensation. It is like Skype, but extend the capability of Skype so that we can transmit tactile sensation. The patient will lie beneath the machine. When the machine push on his or her abdomen, then if there exists some tumor, that area we have larger force. Based on this profile, we create force by force controller, and the doctor will get the similar feeling. Okay, another project. Okay, I already explained about intelligent flying robot, intelligent underwater robot. But how's about the other kind of environment, like in the normal or regular load? So we also have the idea already to make the smart car. So for us, we don't need to drive anymore. We just perform like the passenger. If you want to go to, for example, Siam Paragon, you just type Siam Paragon, and then everything is conducted by the smart car. So we need only passenger, we don't need the driver. In order to implement smart car or intelligent vehicle, any vehicle, it involved with two parameters that we need to control, that is speed and also the orientation. And speed involved with two things, that is the throttle valve. If you open more throttle valve, there'll be more fuel and air to the engine, then the speed will be higher. And also the other component, it is the brake system. If you want to decelerate your vehicle, then you need a brake system. Okay, this is the video that show how the adaptive cruise control system was implemented. We install servo motor on the passenger car. It is Mitsubishi Garland. And based on the command, like for example, we set the speed at 130 kilometers per hour. If the speed is higher or slower, then the throttle valve will be open or closed according to the error, and then we can maintain the speed. This is a normal concept in any cruise control system. Some are already available in some model of the car. But it is more special in such the way that if the leading vehicle run at the speed slower than the set speed, for example, we set at 120 km per hour, but if the leading vehicle run at 60 km per hour, then we have to change the mode. Instead of speed control, we have to change to the distance control. So we install some of the sensors which can detect the distance. We use two parameters in order to control brake system by using fuzzy controller. Firstly, the relative velocity. We detect the speed of the leading vehicle compared with our speed. If it is not zero, then we increase or decrease the speed. Similarly, we consider the current distance. Okay, if it is shorter or longer than the desired distance, okay, sometimes if it is too close, it may be unsafety. Then we either push the brake or we may change the throttle valve angle. That is the first element. The other element, it is the element used to control the heading. If we want to make a vehicle run autonomously without driver, we need to have the system which can control the steering wheel of the smart car. Here we install AC motor. Okay, actually this is the video that I take it from Thailand Intelligent Vehicle Challenge, AAT, and Thai Robotics Society organized it for 3 years, starting from 2008, 9, and this is the video during the final competition. The smart car or the intelligent vehicle, it is installed with several sensors in order to track, follow the waypoint. Okay, there is nobody sit in the car, and there is no remote control. The car run by itself at the maximum speed of 45 kilometers per hour, which is quite fast. Okay, we use the information from GPS. Okay, based on GPS, we compare with the waypoint, because the waypoint will give in the format of latitude and longitude. We consider previous waypoint and the next waypoint. We make a straight line, consider our current position, our current latitude and longitude, see whether the orientation of the vehicle is in parallel with this straight line or not. If it is not, try to control the steering wheel so that it run in parallel. And the other parameter is the distance of the vehicle to the straight line which connect between previous and the next waypoint. We try to control two parameters, heading and at the same time the distance that connect the two waypoints. Finally, the vehicle, it will be able to move follow the way path. By using this concept, like if you want to go to Chiang Mai, go to San Kampang, you just type San Kampang and then let vehicle go for you. It has the ability to obey traffic light, traffic sign. Actually, it was supposed to be able to avoid clashing with the obstacle. But sometimes, like in the competition, you can see if we have a very sharp curvature, then sometimes it miss and it cannot avoid. Sometimes it clash. But if it is a straight line, mostly the robot can detect, the vehicle can detect and avoid clashing with the obstacle. So this team is the champion team. It is called as Khun Chai, yes. And we can also apply this concept for automatic parking system. Actually, if we have bird eye view kind of sensor, like the vision which can detect the whole environment, it will be very easy to design the path for conducting automatic parking. But in reality, it is not easy to get that kind of information. It must be a very local sensor. So based on very limited information about the environment, so we have to find a proper sensor. In this case, I show with the sensor using concept of laser to detect the profile. If there is no vehicle, then it see, and then it try to design the path. It will be like nobody need to control the steering wheel, because everything will be conduct in without human. Okay. After we conduct the Thailand Intelligent Vehicle Challenge for 3 years, the student complains because it's too easy for them. I can't believe, because actually it is already difficult in my point of view, but they complain that why don't think about more challenge problem. Finally, after some discussion with committee of the Thai Robotics Society, finally we change from Thailand Intelligent Vehicle Challenge to Bicilobo Competition Thailand Championship. In Bicilobo, the rules are exactly the same as Thailand Intelligent Vehicle Challenge, that the vehicle, it must be able to follow or track the waypoint. Okay, this is the first thing. But we don't focus on traffic light or traffic sign recognition, because we want the competition to be more exciting. And mostly when we are the audience, we focus more on like speed control or speed competition. Then we focus on the speed. Here, besides tracking, following the waypoint, the bicycle, it must be able to balance. We have the rule that set the dimension of the bicycle so that in the future, a normal people with the weight of around 60 to 65 kilograms can sit on the bicycle as the passenger. He or she doesn't need to lie the bicycle, just sit on the bicycle. There are several techniques that can be applied to balance bicycle. This is the team from AIT. The name is MiniMecha. It uses concept of gyroscope. Okay, we study physics in high school. Actually, we study in the first year of high school. We know angular momentum, which is the multiplication of moment of inertia with the angular velocity. The rate of change of angular momentum create torque. So if our bicycle is leaning to the left or it is falling to the left, then we just think about the change of the angular momentum that can create the vector which points to the front direction. By using right-hand rule, the bicycle will fall back to the opposite side. And if it falls to the right, then we just do in opposite way, change the angular momentum in such a way that the vector goes to the back. So this team applied this concept and could conquer the championship of the second year. The second technique, which is more difficult and it is quite good because we can run the bicycle at very high speed by using concept of centrifugal force. We know from high school, first year of high school, force is mv squared over r. If we vary either speed or vary the radius, then we can change the centrifugal force. And based on that, we'll be able to control so that if it is falling to the left, then we make either increase the speed or we make the radius smaller in such a way that the centrifugal force will make the bicycle lean to the opposite direction. But unfortunately, in the competition, the second team from AIT also, we could not finish waypoint tracking. So it just go out from the lens after a few seconds. But if we have enough space, it will never fall. It will never fall. And even in this video tape, you can see how robust the bicycle is. Even you do high kick and high jump and kick to the bicycle, it is robust enough. It doesn't fall. It is to that level. Okay. So this is also some development about Segway. But Segway is easy. You may see this kind of robot from many developers already. It applies concept of invert pendulum, front and back, which is much, much easier than controlling the bicycle on the left and on the right. Now, I have some doctoral students who are conducting a unicycle and single-wheel robot. It means that we have only one wheel, and we have to control so in such a way that it doesn't fall to the front and back, it doesn't fall to the left and to the right. Actually, Honda or Toyota, I'm not sure, they already make single-wheel robot, but they use concept of invert pendulum along both directions, because if it falls to the front, they increase the speed in such a way that it doesn't fall. But if it leans to the left or leans to the right, there are many small wheels in such a way that if it falls to the left, the small wheel will make the speed to the left in such a way that it moves back. So they use concept of invert pendulum. But we are making the unicycle which apply different concept between longitudinal and lateral. Longitudinal, we still apply the invert pendulum concept. But in the lateral direction, we will use the concept from the bicycle that apply to gyros and change. These two gyros will rotate in opposite direction. And based on changing the rate of change of the speed of these two gyros, we will be able to control even heading direction and also the lateral balancing of the unicycle. I hope that next year, if I have a chance, if Dr. Navid organized this technology event again, I will show how unicycle works. Actually, it is already in the lab, but it is not successfully controlled yet. How long do I have? 5 minutes, okay. Then the other project is the project about development of the exoskeleton. What is exoskeleton? It is not endoskeleton. Endoskeleton is just bone we have. If we make endoskeleton robot, oh, it is quite scary because you have to make operation, put some robot inside, so it is not very popular. But if we put exoskeleton robot, it will work like the shirt or trouser or pants. Then what we need to do is just to use it, we can apply it for two purpose, depending whether the robot follow you or you follow the robot. If you design in such the way that the robot follow you, the robot has to detect your motion, and then based on your motion, the robot handle all the external force. Like instead of using big crane, then we can just wear exoskeleton. Actually, now I have one order from the building construction company SCG that to make the power suit that carry cement bag with the weight of 50 kilograms. We will have the press conference on that robot in August, and it will be live broadcast on TV also. You can see, but because it is not placed released yet, then I don't show it today. So the first application is when we move, the robot detect our motion, and then it move follow our motion. Here we need to apply some kind of sensor that can detect our motion, like we can use some force sensor, encoder, potentiometer, or we can use higher technology like signal from EMG, which is more stable than signal from EEG. But of course, signal from EEG from the brain also possible, but they are not very, very reliable yet. Even though in the laboratory it's okay, but in real implementation, I still don't decide to use that signal yet because it is not very, very reliable. The other group, the robot or the exoskeleton, it is used, it is applied in such a way that the robot move first, we move follow the robot. So this group of exoskeleton, they are used for rehabilitation. Like we can see that in Thailand, there are three machines, Locomat, that are used for rehabilitation. So the robot move, the patient will suffer from some accident or have some paraplegia or some other disease that he has problem in moving or walking, has to pass some training or the rehabilitation program. So we developed many prototypes, starting from using the pneumatic actuator, but there are some problems because the accuracy of position control is not very good, even though it is quite flexible. Then we change to the hydraulic actuator, which is quite good. And the last one I didn't show here, it is the version that use electrical motor. So this also another kind of the exoskeleton. This one, it was designed in such a way to replace the wheelchair, because nowadays the patient will suffer from paraplegia, hemiplegia. He or she need to sit on wheelchair. But wheelchair has a lot of limitation because we need to have a proper slope. It can't walk on the stairway and et cetera. So we think about making the robot like Asimo, but it must have ability to detect the center of gravity. If the patient is falling, it has to send and change gate motion in such a way that the patient never fall. But after we make this for 4 years, we found that we could only make the robot move follow our gate motion, but it could not balance and walk properly because, of course, we have limit budget that we can't do manufacturing that use very, very high strength, and there are some problem about clearance, backlash in the mod, in the gear system, and etc. Finally, we could not successfully complete this project. But anyway, we still have concept, and if we have a new funding, we are willing to continue it again. So this is another application of exoskeleton for virtual reality. In the market, you may see Phantom, not Phantom of the Opera, it is a kind of device used in virtual reality. But the limitation of Phantom is that it can create at most of around 200 or 300 gram force, which is very, very, very little. But in many virtual reality, we need to have more rigid virtual environment. For example, you may have a virtual wall. Okay, if you wear the robot, actually the robot is very heavy. We have to design the robot in such a way that it compensates the gravity and friction so that when you wear the robot, you don't see any resistance. And when it hits with the virtual object, like the virtual wall will create the force. And we design so that it can create at most of 2 kilogram in any direction. It means that in some point it can create up to even 5 kilogram force, which is quite large. And the last project, actually this is not for future application, but because I teach control, dynamic control, so it is my personal interest of controlling invert pendulum. Here we have only one motor that controls the motion of the moving cart, and that joint, it is free. You can see that by conducting a proper control algorithm, it can swing up the invert pendulum and then maintain its stability. This is the concept that we can apply for the humanoid robot. This is also another type of the invert pendulum. It is called as the rotary type invert pendulum, or sometimes we call as the furuta type, following the name of the person who introduced this type of invert pendulum. Professor Furuta is the rector of Tokyo Denki University. We know each other very well. And this is also the other type of the invert pendulum, that we have 2-degree freedom. We have to control balancing along both X and Y direction. And the last presentation, it is about ball bot. We have a ball, we have a machine. The machine has to balance itself on the ball. Okay, this is without control, definitely robot will fall. Now, one of my doctoral students, Khun Kanchana Phan, actually he is the advisor of SCUBA team. SCUBA is the team which conquered championship of RoboCup in World RoboCup for several years. Khun Kanchana Phan, he is the advisor of that team. Now he continue his PhD at AIT. He is making 2-link ball bot. So there will be 2 ball. Okay, this is the first section. In the second section, we put another ball and another section of the robot. So the robot, it must be able to send the leaning angle of both bottom and the high section, and it has to try to control the motion of all the wheels. So there are several mechanisms to design this wheel. So this is one type. The second one, actually, he brought it on 2 days ago, but finally, because he is not available yesterday and today, he could not demonstrate to you. Otherwise, you can see that second version. Okay. So it is quite robust. Even we provide some disturbance, you push them, but the robot will balance. Okay. Because in Thailand, because I'm Thai, I'm sorry, I may not be so much in international, but I'm Thai, we have the organization Thai Robotics Society, which try to stimulate, try to help the development of R&D. We have some company which are already established. When we organize robot competition, okay, the first year is okay, everybody happy. Second year, third year is okay, very good. But from fourth year, fifth year, what's then? What's next? We are champion of World RoboCup for several years. Both Cuba from Kasesat University, Chulalongkorn, and from Rescue Robot, we are champion for 6 years already. But what's next? So this is the problem that the players start to ask us, the roboticists, whether what we should do next. So now it is the process that we have to spin out from laboratory scale into the scale that we can make our own brand name. So from now on, in 5 years, you will see, I promise you that you will see more than 3. I can promise that there will be more than 3 robotics companies which are launched, which are established in Thailand. And they will do a lot of different activities. Thai government is quite good. Even though they are complaining a lot, several things, but actually they support science technology quite okay, I think. This year, there will be some funding for around 100 million in order to establish business in medical robotics. So these are the environment of the R&D in robotics field in Thailand. And if you are interested in this field, you are very most welcome to discuss your idea. Okay, thank you very much.